In November 2014, the city of Berkeley, California passed a penny per ounce excise tax on sugar-sweetened beverages, the first tax of its size and type in the United States. The tax was intended to raise revenue for programs that improve children's health and to improve all Berkeley residents' nutrition by encouraging people to buy fewer taxed sugary beverages and more untaxed drinks like plain water or other unsweetened milks, juices, or teas. Beverages with added sugars that are now taxed include regular sodas, energy drinks, sports drinks, sweetened juice drinks and flavored waters, and ready-to-drink sweetened coffees and teas. As more cities around the U.S. and countries around the globe pass similar sugary drink taxes, it's important to look at what people are buying and drinking after taxes go into effect, as well as changes in beverage prices, store revenues, and customer spending to see if taxes are working as intended. That's exactly what this study did in Berkeley by comparing data from before and after tax collection began in March 2015. First, researchers surveyed beverage prices before and after the tax began in 26 Berkeley stores to see whether the full penny per ounce tax was being passed along from distributors to consumers as intended. They found that tax pass-through was complete in large and small chain supermarkets and chain gas stations, partial in pharmacies, and negative in independent corner stores and independent gas stations, possibly due to delayed tax implementation for these self-distributing stores. Researchers then examined point-of-sale scanner data from 15.5 million checkouts in large Berkeley and neighboring Bay Area supermarkets. They found that sugary drink sales volumes in Berkeley stores dropped 9.6% compared to estimates of sales if the tax had not been in place, while sales volumes of sugary drinks rose 6.9% in stores outside Berkeley. Untaxed beverage sales volumes rose 3.5% in Berkeley stores versus only 0.5% in stores outside Berkeley. Sales of plain water, in particular, increased 15.6% in Berkeley compared to a 4.4% drop in neighboring cities. Overall beverage sales, regardless of taxes, increased slightly in both Berkeley and non-Berkeley stores. The study found no evidence of higher grocery bills for consumers, no loss of gross revenue per transaction for stores, and no decreases in overall beverage sales for stores, while still achieving the desired reduction in sales volume of sugar-sweetened beverages in Berkeley. Finally, researchers interviewed nearly 1,000 adult Berkeley residents by phone to learn about where they shopped and what beverages they drank the previous day, both before and after the tax began, to see if there were any changes. They found that compared to the rest of the country, residents of Berkeley already had relatively low intake of sugary drinks before the tax went into effect. Self-reported average daily intake of sugary drinks did decrease from baseline to the post-tax period, but these differences were not statistically significant. Residents did not report shifting their shopping outside of Berkeley. So what do all these findings mean? In its first year, the nation's first large sugar-sweetened beverage tax led to increased sugary drink prices in many store settings. It led to decreased sales of taxed sugary drinks in Berkeley without affecting overall beverage sales volumes, and average customers' grocery bills did not increase. This is all promising for the tax policy. Declines in sugary drink sales combined with new revenue generated to use for local health programs could contribute significantly to keeping Berkeley area residents healthy. To learn more about this study, follow this link to check out the full article in PLOS Medicine.